End of chapter 12. The Gilded Age, A Tale of Today by Mark Twain and C.D. Warner. Chapter 13.
Whatever to say betoken his intente, his language was so fair and pertinente, yet seemeth unto many hearing not only the word, but verily the thinning.
Caxton's Book of Courtesy. In the party of which our travelers found themselves members was Duff Brown, the great railroad contractor, and subsequently a well-known member of Congress. A bluff, jovial Boston man, thick-set, close-shaven, with a heavy jaw and a low forehead. A very pleasant man, if you were not in his way. He had government contracts also, custom houses and dry docks from Portland to New Orleans, and managed to get out of Congress, in appropriations, about weight for weight of gold for the stone furnished. Associated with him, and also of this party, was Rodney Shake, a sleek New York broker, a man as prominent in the church as in the stock exchange, dainty in his dress, smooth of speech, the necessary complement of Duff Brown in any enterprise that needed assurance and adroitness. It would be difficult to find a pleasanter traveling party, one that shook off more readily the artificial restraints of puritanic strictness, and took the world with good-natured allowance. Money was plenty for every attainable luxury, and there seemed to be no doubt that its supply would continue, and that fortunes were about to be made without a great deal of toil. Even Philip soon caught the prevailing spirit. Barry did not need any inoculation. He always talked in six figures. It was as natural for the dear boy to be rich as it is for most people to be poor. The elders of the party were not long in discovering the fact, which almost all travelers to the West soon find out, that the water was poor. It must have been by a lucky premonition of this that they all had brandy flasks with which to qualify the water of the country, and it was no doubt from an uneasy feeling of the danger of being poisoned that they kept experimenting, mixing a little of the dangerous and changing fluid as they passed along with the contents of the flasks, thus saving their lives hour by hour. Philip learned afterwards that temperance and the strict observance of Sunday and a certain gravity of deportment are geographical habits which people do not usually carry with them away from home. Our travelers stopped in Chicago long enough to see that they could make their fortunes there in 2 weeks' time, but it did not seem worth while. The West was more attractive. The further one went, the wider the opportunities opened. They took railroad to Alton, and the steamboat from there to St. Louis for the change and to have a glimpse of the river.
"Isn't this jolly?"
cried Henry, dancing out of the barber's room and coming down the deck with a 1-2-3 step, shaven, curled, and perfumed after his usual exquisite fashion.
"What's jolly?"
asked Philip, looking out upon the dreary and monotonous waste through which the shaking steamboat was coughing its way.
"Why, the whole thing! It's immense, I can tell you. I wouldn't give that to be guaranteed 100,000 cold cash in a year's time."
"Where's Mr. Brown?"
"He is in the saloon, playing poker with Shike and that long-haired party with the striped trousers, who scrambled aboard when the stage plank was half hauled in, and the big delegate to Congress from out west."
"That's a fine-looking fellow, that delegate, with his glossy black whiskers. Looks like a Washington man. I shouldn't think he'd be at poker." "Oh, it's only 5 cent ante, just to make it interesting," the delegate said.
"But I shouldn't think a representative in Congress would play poker anyway in a public steamboat.